And then make a commitment with the Lord to return to Him whatever He puts in your heart on a regular basis. If all of us do that, we will contribute and we'll be ready to do the work whenever the Lord plans for us to start. Very simple, isn't it? Person asked, how much should I give? That's up to the Lord to tell you how much you should give. Give whatever He puts in your heart. But when He tells you something, do it. Our text today is found in John chapter 10. And it has to do with the conversation that was being held between Jesus and, as always, the scribes and the Pharisees. Now, Jesus was walking in the porch of the temple, which was called Solomon's Porch. And they asked him this question: how long do you keep us in doubt? They wanted to know whether Jesus was the Messiah, whether Jesus was the one that was promised to come or not. And Jesus answered very simply by saying, I told you and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. You have seen my works. You have seen how I operate. And you have seen that is not the natural way. So you should already understand, be convinced that I have come from God. But then Jesus said, but you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. And our text that gave birth to the topic for this morning, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. Jesus points out that his people is identified in two ways. Number one, they hear his voice. Number two, they follow, they obey his voice. And when it comes to our time, this is still the way that God's people are to be recognized or identified. It is imperative. It is essential. It is extremely important that we be identified as the people who hear and who follow God's voice. And in order for us to be so identified, we must pay attention to God, to the voice of God. We must have our ears tuned to His voice. Unfortunately, this is not what is happening. As you know, the majority doesn't pay attention, doesn't hear the voice of God. And when you don't pay attention and hear the voice of God, your heart becomes hardened. See, because God has something that He wants you to do. God has some instructions that He wants you to follow. God has some ways of planning for your life that may be different than the ways you are planning for your lives yourselves. But if you don't pay attention on here, if you ignore what He has been saying, then your heart will become hardened. However, we should not be fooled because there is a consequence. See, some people think because God is merciful, is loving, is kind, and His mercy is forever and so on, He's gracious, nothing is going to happen. God is love. But remember that God is also righteous. God is just. Sooner or later, You have to pay the price for neglecting to hear and to follow the voice of God. Jesus alerted in his time those who were hearing him that, especially in his parables, he said, if you have an ear, you better hear what I'm saying. When Jesus talked about the end of the world, he gave us an example, the experience of Noah. He mentioned that Noah preached for 120 years. And how many people heard his voice? How many people were saved? Only 8 people were saved. And the reason for that was very clear. They did not pay attention to what Noah was telling them. They neglected, they ignored. Now Jesus went on and he said in verses 38 and 39 of Matthew 24, as it was in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. They were busy. They were involved in many things. Jesus says, and they did not know until the flood came and took them all away. He said, that's the way it's going to be when the coming of the Son of Man is near. We're living at a time we believe is the time when Jesus is about to come. It's a very sensitive time. It's a very dangerous time. It's a very unpredictable time. Some of us are prophesying or making an attempt to prophesy about what's going to happen in the near future. You know, all these leaders that are elected and re-elected and then replaced by others and so on, they all play a part in the events that culminate with the coming of Jesus. But no one of us can say this is the one or that is the one. So we just have to keep our eyes open and to keep our ears tuned to the voice of God. Revelation 3, 14 to 16 and 19 to 20, talking about the church in the time or period of the end, specifically directing words to the Laodiceans. You know, the church in the end is very rich. I mean, we have received so much. We have read the Bibles, hopefully, several times. We have been instructed by the spirit of prophecy. We, more than anybody else, should consider ourselves very rich, shouldn't we? Rich in knowledge. Well, to the church that is rich in knowledge, the faithful witness says, and this is Jesus talking to the church, and he says, I know your works, that you are neither cold or hot. And he says, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Then he says, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous and do what? Repent. And then he goes and he says, I'm knocking at the door. And if anyone do what? Hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in, dine with him, and he with me. We cannot ignore what God is saying to us, whether in the Bible or in the spirit of prophecy. We should not ignore what God is saying to us. Hebrews 12:25 says, see that you do not refuse him who speaks. For if they did not escape, who refused him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven. And God speaks from heaven to us through the scriptures and through the spirit of prophecy. We need to be very careful. To be very careful. Because if we don't pay attention, and I would say carefully, to what God is saying, if we don't hear well because of our neglect, because of our busyness, and so on, we may pay a very, very hard price. I'm going to give you two examples from the Bible. First one comes from the experience of Moses and Aaron. You find it in your Bibles in the book of Numbers, chapter 20, verses 3 to 12. I'm summarizing it so that we will go right to the point. Moses and Aaron were leading out God's people through the wilderness. And then it comes a time when they have no water to drink. So the people contended with Moses. They argued with Moses and Aaron. And they accused Moses and Aaron of bringing them through the wilderness for them to die. We have no water to drink. Our animals have no water to drink. What are we going to do? Moses and Aaron went from the assembly of the people to the presence of the Lord. They came to the tabernacle. And at the door of the tabernacle, they knelt. They fell on their faces, and the Bible says the glory of the Lord appeared to them. Now, if you have your Bibles open to chapter 20 of Numbers, notice what it says in verse 7. Numbers 20, verse 7. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron. The Lord said, take the rod. That's the rod of Aaron. Take the rod, you and your brother Aaron. Gather the congregation together. Speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will yield its water. Thus you shall bring water for them out of the rock, and give drink to the congregation and their animals. The story continues. So Moses took the rod from before the Lord, as he commanded them. And Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock. And then Moses said to them, hear now, you rebels. Must we bring water for you out of this rock? Then Moses lifted his hand and he struck the rock twice with his rod. And water came out abundantly. And the congregation, their animals drank. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron. Because you did not believe me to hallow me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them. Now what happened here? Did God give Moses and Aaron explicit, clear instructions on how to resolve the problem of lack of water in the wilderness so that the people and the animals would drink water? Did God give them explicit, clear instructions? Well, just read it here. It's very clear. Take the rod, you and your brother Aaron, gather the congregation together, speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will yield the water. Is that clear, Lorraine? There's no big deal there. Very clear instructions. Now, did Moses follow what he heard from God when he went about trying to resolve the problem that the people had with lack of water? No. What did Moses do? He did several things wrong, right? Number one, what did he do? He allowed his feelings to take over what God had instructed him to do. He was very upset with the people for complaining. The people had been complaining since they left Egypt. And Moses, you see, we all have egos, don't we? And Moses allowed his ego to go, you know, and take place, the place of God's straight, direct instructions. So he says to the people, you bunch of what? Rebels. You bunch of rebels. Did God tell him to tell the people that they were rebels? No. God didn't say that to him. Then he says, as part of his, you know, following God's instructions, must we, who is we here? Who is we here? Him and Aaron. Must we bring water? He's taking the glory to whom? To himself of bringing water. Must we bring water out of this rock for you? Did God tell him to do that? No. Two things against him already. And then the third thing, he lifted the rod of Aaron that God said, take the rod of Aaron, but he didn't say to lift the rock, the rod and hit the rock. Did he? But he went on, hit the rock twice. Did God tell him to hit the rock twice? No. So he did all the things God didn't tell him to do. Now, what is interesting in this story is that in spite of his disobedience, in spite of the fact that he didn't follow the instructions of the Lord, did God give water to the people? Yes. It's true, God is very patient. He takes a lot from us. We go our ways many times. We follow our opinions many times. We neglect the exact instruction of God, and we put in something else. We add to what God has said. We interpret what God has said. And God is still in His mercy and His love. He accepts us and He works with us. But it's very dangerous not to follow the instructions of God. What happened to Moses and Aaron? They had got out of Egypt to take the people into the promised land. Did they go into the promised land? The Bible says, because you and Aaron, because you did not what? Believe me. See, when God speaks, that's it. That's it. Stops right there. There's no place for questioning God. He knows better. Says, by not following my instructions, you demonstrated that you did not believe in my words. And then he says, and because you didn't hallow me, because you didn't glorify me, because you didn't make me holy before the people, you and Aaron are not going to go into the land which I have given them. That was the consequence. This illustrates a very important point. God not only expects us to listen carefully to what he says, but also to follow very carefully what he says. You understand what I'm saying? Not just to hear what he says, but to follow what he says. Besides, God doesn't want me to add or subtract from what he says. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5 and 6, every word of God is pure. He is a shield to those who put their trust in him. And then he says, do not add to his words. And he says, do not subtract from his words. The second biblical example that I find is the story of the prophet Elisha. You know, there is a prophet named Elijah. Elisha took his place. The prophet Elisha and this man, an Arabian general named Naaman. Naaman was afflicted with leprosy. Now, the story found in 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 through 15. Let me summarize it. The Arameans, they lived in what is now known as modern Syria. And they were neighbors and rivals to the people of Israel. And once in a while, they went and they had wars against Israel. They took in prisoners, made them slaves. Well, a slave girl that they captured from the Israelites to run during one of those raids, she came to work for Naaman, this general. And when she saw Naaman suffering from leprosy, she told him, there is a prophet in Israel. If you go to him, he'll heal you. So Naaman asked permission of the king of the Arameans, permission to go to Israel. And the king prepared a letter, gave it to him, and said, take this letter to the king of Israel. And in the letter, the king said to the king of Israel, I'm sending Naaman to you for you to heal him. Well, the king of Israel got a little upset with the letter, said, who am I? When he received the letter, who am I to heal anybody? I think this king of the Arameans is trying to make war with me. That's what he's trying to do. And while he was doubting what to do, the prophet Elisha sent him a note saying, send Naaman to me. Don't worry about it, because he's going to know that there is a God in Israel. And so Naaman went with his, you know, group of people that he brought from wherever he came to the prophet Elisha. When he got there, he wanted to meet prophet Elisha, but Elisha did not appear. Elisha sent a servant of his outside and told Naaman, you go and you wash in the Jordan River. How many times? Seven times. Now, a prophet is a spokesman for God. So he's speaking what God's communicating to him. So the words, the instructions that Elisha was giving to Naaman were instructions from whom? From God himself. So Naaman heard the word of God. But what did he do? He got very upset. He got very upset. He said to himself, probably, I thought this guy would come out, would meet me. I'm a general after all. You'd, you know, salute me. He'd do some rituals. He'd put his hands to the air. He'd do something. I thought he'd, you know, he comes and sends me this fellow here to tell me to bathe in the Jordan River. We got better rivers in the place where I came from. Oh, no. And then he turned around, was ready to go back home, very upset. And while he was on the way back, his servant now came to him and said, Naaman, general, if the prophet had told you to do something really difficult, wouldn't you do it? He told you just to bathe in the Jordan River. That's not difficult. You don't lose anything. And he thought about it and said, you're right. So he went, and he went bathed seven times in the Jordan River. And what does the Bible say? He went down, dipped seven times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. You know, it always pays to follow what God says. And then it says, his flesh was restored, like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. You know what was the problem here? When we close our ears because the word is spoken to us, is uncomfortable or unacceptable to our egos. When we selectively tune our ears to hear only what we want to hear or expect to hear, we do not hear the word spoken to us as a word of grace. That becomes a word of judgment. We go away from the encounter like Naaman, still bearing the marks of our disease. Whatever prevents us from hearing the word spoken to us from God because we don't want to give up what we do or what we are doing or thinking the way we do, or because we fear what others will think of us because we are following what we heard from God. When we do this, whatever prevents us from hearing the word of God will keep us from enjoying the blessings of healing that comes from God. We've been studying in Bible class, it's Sabbath school time. Today we were talking about something very interesting. We were talking about the diet that God prescribed for Adam and Eve. What was the diet, Aisha? He said you should eat so many what? And fruits, right? Very simple diet. I mean, it's very clear in the Bible, isn't it? Did you hear that from God? It's very clear there. Now, after man sinned, what did God do? After man sinned, what did God do? He added what? Herb of the field, vegetables. Men were able to live long lives eating just these three things: nuts or grains, and fruits and vegetables, even after sin. Wasn't it, Myron? When Noah comes around, many years after the creation, man was eating only these three things, supposedly, right? The fact is that we read in the Bible that they lived a long life. How many of us have paid attention to that? That's what God said. We have heard about it, haven't we? Have we followed? And then we come to the end of times, and God, by inspiring Ellen White, instructs us that we have to go back to what? Our original diet. If we don't want to suffer what? The consequences of the wrong diet that came after the flood. And what do? We keep on insisting on the wrong diet when we heard from God that we should use God's diet. This is an example. That which came to be our salvation now is judging us and is telling us that we're guilty because we didn't follow it. So when we are sick today, who should we blame? Ourselves. That's all. In Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21, I read, "Your ears shall hear a word behind you, saying, this is the way, walk in it, whenever you turn to the right hand or whenever you turn to the left." Your left or my left doesn't matter. God has spoken. God has said it. It's all here. If you don't open this book, if you don't read this book, you don't know what God said. It's going to be very difficult for you to follow. If you don't read this book, what you're doing is to follow your own intuition, your own opinion, your own ideas. And that is very dangerous. In Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7 and 8, the Apostle Paul says that God's voice is a today's voice. It says, today, if you hear his voice, do not what? Harden your hearts, as in the rebellion. Each time you put other things ahead of God, each time you go to your own interests and business and sacrifice God's interests and business, each time you listen to another voice rather than waiting to hear his voice, you grow a little harder and a lot more difficult for God to speak to you. You see, because Jesus said, my people hear my voice. In order to hear his voice, we have to be acquainted with him. They know. I know them and they know me. God will never force you to obey him. But he expects you to respond to his call. It's shameful what's happening. So many people today, they are ready to listen to hear the voice of so many others. And they forget to pay attention to the voice of God. It's like this fellow that told me that he had a GPS in his smartphone. Do you have GPS in your smartphone? We all do it today, right? But he said his GPS didn't help him very much. Every time he put the address in the GPS, but he got lost. I said, is that so? And then I discover that this fellow would put the address on the GPS, turn on his car, start, the GPS would say, turn left. The next one, he said, no. That's not right. You gotta go right. And you turn right. And then the GPS would start saying, make a U-turn. Say, make a U-turn, nothing. I'm going straight. That's the way to go. He always got lost. Now, what was a GPS made to do? To be followed, right? If we don't follow, what's going to happen? We're going to get lost. God spoke to us. God instructed us. God is speaking to us. His voice was given to us so that we would follow. If we don't follow God's voice, we will be lost. As simple as that. That's why Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice. I know them. They know me. The wisest thing a sheep can do is follow the shepherd. He always has the best interest at heart. He always leads them to green pastures. He always provides for and protects them. So today, to hear God's voice. Once again, I'm inviting you to hear God's voice. God is continuously speaking to us, to His Word. But you gotta open it up and read it. And keep on reading. And keep on reading. Don't add to His words. Don't subtract from His words. You should respond in a very simple way. Follow. Follow. And follow. My sheep hear my voice, and they follow me. May God help us and direct us toward His kingdom, is my prayer. Amen.
Please stand for closing hymn. 623, I will follow thee, my Savior. I will follow thee, my Savior, wheresoever my lot may be. Where thou goest, I will follow. Yes, my Lord, I'll follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake me, by thy grace I'll follow thee. Though the road be rough and thorny, trackless as the foaming sea, thou hast trod this way before me, and I'll gladly follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior.
Thou didst shed thy blood for me, and though all men should forsake thee, by thy grace I'll follow thee. Though I meet with tribulations, sorely tempted though I be, I remember thou was tempted and rejoice to follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake thee, by thy grace I'll follow thee. Though thou leadest me affliction, or forsaken though I be, thou wast destitute, afflicted, and I only follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake thee, by thy grace I'll follow thee. Though to Jordan's rolling billows, cold and deep thou leadest me, thou hast crossed the waves before me, and I still will follow thee. I will follow thee, my Savior, thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake me, by thy grace I'll follow thee.
Dear Heavenly Father, we all have temptations that separate us from you and your word. Ourselves. We are selfish. Our egos many times are obstacles, barriers. And your word cannot do the effect it is supposed to do in our lives. To many of us, to follow you may mean changes. The changes may not go according to our understanding, according to our will, and because of it, we decide to ignore your word. My prayer is that you help us to understand that you have created us and you know what is best for us. So help us to submit to you, to depend on what you say, to live by what you say. Jesus told us that we are to live by every word that comes out of your mouth. Help us not to complicate things, but to follow carefully everything that you say to us. So inspire us to read the Bible, to read your instructions for these last days given to us by the Spirit of prophecy. To open our minds to whatever we read, so that we'll be intelligent enough to make the right decisions. Help us to open our doors, because Jesus is knocking and he wants to come in and dine with us, enjoy with us the blessings that he has promised to us. If we haven't yet decided to follow him, if we haven't yet decided to be baptized and open ourselves totally to the guidance of the Holy Spirit, help us to do so right now. Help us not to procrastinate. As we leave this place, send the angels to protect us. Bless us in the rest of the Sabbath day. And keep us close to you as we pay attention to your word. In the name of Jesus, amen.
And you may be seated as you'll be ushered out soon and very soon.